Christ alone. What a great theme we've been having. Christ alone. Christ is unique. Christ is everything. My topic for today is Christ is our hope. But if I had to have another title, I would call it this morning, Land of Hope and Glory. So if that inspires you to start singing, we can do that bit later on. I'm going to quote a few different scriptures. Feel free to just either listen, or if you want to jump about with your Bible, that's great as well. We're going to be focusing largely on Romans 8, but we've got a couple of verses leading up to that before we get there. So, why Land of Hope and Glory? Well, Colossians 1:27 says this. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you, the hope of glory. And I want us very much to understand this morning that what we're talking about and everything we're talking about is this idea that you are incredibly special, and that there is something going on in you, whether you realize it or not. But if you do realize what's going on within you, it's going to give you a better week next week than you had last week. Because if you come to a realization of what's going to been going on in your life, it will change the way you think about your circumstances. And that's really what I want to focus on right now. This great mystery, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now, I think last time I spoke, or the time before, I actually talked about hope. So I don't want to go over old ground, but just in case you're not here, I want to make sure you understand what the Christian word hope is, because it's not the same as the way that other people use the word. I think last time I said I had hope that Sunderland would win the Premiership. If you've been following the season so far, when I say I hope that Sunderland will be in the Premiership, you will understand how weak and measly and miserable that word hope can be when it's used by normal people. Do you understand? The word hope is just like this, it's possible, but I don't think it's likely. That's not the way Christians use the word hope. The way Christians use the word hope is totally different. So let me just make absolutely plain that we understand what we're talking about. We have a relationship between the word faith and the word hope. And I still can't think of anything better to describe this than this mix between faith, hope, and love. And the easiest illustration, and I know I've said it before, so please bear with me, but it is Christmas Eve. If you've got kids on Christmas Eve, you will understand, or if you've been a kid on Christmas Eve, which I guess is everybody, it means you will understand the difference between faith, hope, and love, right? It goes like this. We understand that our parents love us, hopefully, yeah? And because of that, on Christmas Eve, we get excited. Why? Let's be blunt. Children are pragmatic. Why are they excited on Christmas Eve? It's not for religious reasons. Presents. So what happens is, because they know they're loved by their parents, they believe, faith, that tomorrow they're getting presents. Is that right? There's an absolute certainty. It's Christmas Eve, there's presents coming. Now, when I was a kid, you might have had an apple and an orange and a sock and one little wrappy up, but it was still presents. We came from poor families. Did you used to get a sock and an apple and a sock hung on the mantelpiece? If you give a kid one of those socks today as a Christmas present, The point is this. The child implicitly knows what lies ahead the next day, and that we can understand is faith. It's a certainty of knowledge. What does that certainty of knowledge produce? It produces a feeling inside. And what's that feeling? Yay! Excitement. That's the word for hope. So whenever you read the word hope in the New Testament, I want you to allow yourself a little moment, because that's what it's about. Be excited. Every time you see the word hope written in the New Testament, it is something for you to celebrate. It's something for you to jump up and down about. It's something for you to get absolutely thrilled about, because something's going to happen. And we can have an absolute certainty that something's going to happen. So when Paul is writing in sin, the glorious riches of the mystery which is in Christ, and which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, this is something for us to get excited about this morning. Christ is in you. Now, I want to explore what that means. And in fairness, in some ways, I should have changed what I'm saying. Instead of the land of hope and glory, I should have called it this, but it's a bit of a downer. The land of hope and suffering and glory. That sounds a little bit more disinteresting, doesn't it? I hope you haven't switched off. I left the word suffering out on purpose. Because if I said next week we're going to preach on suffering, you wouldn't come. Is that fair? Suffering, it's one of those switch-off moments. Suffering, let's start counting the ceiling tiles and ignore what he says. I mentioned that on Thursday, yeah. But I want you to get excited about it, and I even want you to get excited about the possibility of being excited in suffering. That sounds strange to say from a pulpit, doesn't it? Get excited in suffering. That just sounds absolutely crazy. But I want to explore that this morning, because it's part of what we're going to see when we turn to Romans 8. Before we get there, I'm going to use a verse from John. And John says this in 1 John 3:2. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. But it doesn't yet appear what we shall be. Now, This is important. Christ is in you, and his presence in you is making you into the sons of God. And when I say sons of God, it's a non-gendered term. It means daughters, but you understand where we're coming from here. There's no male or female in Christ, right? No bond or free, no difference between race and color and everything else. We're just one in Christ. So when we say that Christ is in us, and we are going to be the sons of God, we are the sons of God. Christ is now in us, but we don't yet appear to be what we shall be. And that's very true. Because when I look out at you guys, I see a lot of nice but ordinary people. As I look around, I can't see any glowing celebrity, no paragon of beauties and... Oh, I shouldn't say that. I'll just sit down now. No, I see you're all deeply attractive, said he, backpedaling very fast. But friends, let me tell you, what you shall be will be glorious. What you shall be will be true beauty. What you shall be will shine like the sun. Christ is in you, and it is our hope of glory. Now, what it means is this. When we look at each other, we see ordinary. But when God looks down on you, he sees extraordinary. When we see each other, we see, yes, normality. But when we understand that Christ looks us, he sees many Christ's, mini Jesus. We are now the sons of God. We're not yet what we're going to be. We don't appear to be what we're going to be, but we will be one day. And Paul, again, this is the last verse before we get to Romans, and he picks up and expands this in Romans. He says this, for our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. Let me read that again. Concentrate. This is important. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory. Are you in trouble this morning? Do you have problems? I had to pop 2 painkillers before I could stand up to preach this morning. That's nothing, is it? Because some people in here are suffering far, far worse. Let's just read Romans 8 together and start to fully explore what we mean and what's going on and why we can think differently this next week to the way we thought last week. Let me read. Romans 8 and it's 16 to 28. I'm reading from the New International Version. It says this. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now if we are children, then we are heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his suffering in order that we might also share in his glory. I'm going to read that again. We share in his suffering in order that we might share in his glory. For I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. Not to us, but will be revealed in us. The creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed. For creation was subject to frustration, not by its own choice, but the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into glorious freedom of the children of God. And we know the whole of creation has been groaning in pains of childbirth right to this present time. Not only so, but ourselves, who are the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we await our adoption as sons and the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all, for who hopes for what he already has? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We don't know what to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans and words that words cannot express. And he who searches our heart knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints in accordance with God's will. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him and who have been called according to his purpose. For we know that in all things, God works for good for those who love him and who have been called according to his purpose. I don't know about you, but I'm getting excited. I am honestly really getting excited. Because what I'm hearing here is that suffering isn't for my ill, it is for my glory. I'm reading here that I'm part of creation, and creation feels as I do, because there's mornings when I just only groan, and I guess you do too. But that groaning one day will be turned into glory. I will stress, as my wife tells me, mourning isn't the same as groaning. You see, it may be that you've had a devastating divorce. It may be you didn't want your marriage to end, but you're now overwhelmed with a sense of loneliness and defeat. Maybe you've lost a child, a spouse, a parent, a loved one. You're in the throes of grief and loss, and maybe even angry with God. It's possible this morning you've recently lost your job. All you've ever wanted to do was provide for your family. And now that's been taken away from you and there's no jobs on the horizon. Maybe this morning you're gripped by illness that holds your body in pain and holds you in that grip. And such sufferings may cause you to wonder if you can go on. The daily grind of life for some people is almost unbearable, and it is excruciating. And I've got to say, when we come together on a Sunday morning and we say, "How are you?" And you say, "Great." "How are you doing, champion? The Lord bless you." "And the Lord bless you." We just don't know what people go home to. We don't. We don't know what they go back to. We don't know how they feel when the door closes. But I've got good news for you this morning. Paul suggests that your perspective can utterly change when you understand his plan and his purpose and the nature of suffering. So I know you wouldn't want to come here if we'd announced it in advance, but I hope since you're here, you'll bear with me at least as we explore this together. You see, there are some promises in the Word of God that says what things are going to be like in the future. And we haven't got time to explore them all, but I want to outlay them nevertheless. I want to make sure you understand what is going to lie ahead. First, we will be with Christ. Yeah! Hope. Excitement. We will be like him. Absolutely. We will have glory, and there is an incredible wealth of imagery in the Word of God that we're going to try, as I say, and unpack, but we will have glory with Christ. We shall, in some sense, be fed or entertained in the future world to come. And furthermore, we will have some official position in the universe. Because one of the things we're going to get rid of today is the idea that we're all going to be in heaven. We're not. Heaven is temporary until heaven descends upon the new earth. And I spied a new heaven and a new earth. And I saw the holy city come down upon the earth. And we will have our dwelling there. Read the end of Revelation. It's there at the back for a reason. Read what your future is going to be. Don't worry about the early parts of Revelation if you can't understand it. Nobody has. Everybody thinks they do. But the one thing that's very plain at the end is what God's plan is for us. And we will see hints and through the scriptures where it talks about the fact that we will be rulers with Christ. We're going to have a resurrected body. We're not going to waft around as some ghost-like spirits plucking harps on clouds. Our future is far more exciting than any of that. And what's more, this future and this form that we're going to be is directly relatable to what's going on in your life now. We will see figures in the afterlife who shine like the sun. And we will wonder who they were, and we won't know their names. But they might be the people who we pitied the most in this world because of what we thought was their problems instead of seeing what was their glory. I remember a child called Julie. I had an elder in my church in Bromsgrove in Worcestershire. And Julie tore your heartstrings. Julie was 6 years old when we took the pastorate down in Bromsgrove. When we got there, we found that Julie was the size of a 3-year-old, and she had one slight problem. She was missing an enzyme production in her body that allowed it to break down something in the blood. Forgive me, I'm not a medic. But what it meant was, because that enzyme wasn't produced, she had deposits all around her body in all of her organs that normally would be, as I say, dealt with. And what that resulted in was her pituitary gland, for example. I can hear glorious music. Her pituitary gland was clogged and so she couldn't grow. Her tongue was swollen in the mouth, so she couldn't speak. Her eyeballs were like ping pong balls, and she went blind. Every organ in the body was just swollen and not working right. And God bless her. I had to bury her and experience the pain of their mum and dad, who were just absolutely torn apart and devastated. But I've got to tell you, Julie now shines like the sun. And when she gets her glorified body, and when God takes all the suffering that she went through and glorifies it, my Lord. You see, Paul's saying that our suffering here is directly relatable to what we're going to be. Let me just make this clear. There's two types of suffering, incidentally, and we should understand this, because both are relatable here. There's the suffering that comes from the nature of fallen humanity. There's the suffering that all of us experience, yes? Then there's also suffering that comes from being a disciple of Christ. And the rejection of our message, which is the message of Christ, from other people. And believe me, those are only going to get worse in the days to come. I won't go into that now. But persecution is virtually here. The mindset that will allow the church to be persecuted is now reaching tipping point. It won't be long before when you bring your child up as a Christian, you'll be called a child abuser. Because you'll be judgmental. School in Sunderland, Ofsted inspectors, 8-year-old girl being quizzed about her attitude to lesbianism. And because she didn't have an opinion, the school failed because it wasn't inclusive in its teaching to those classes. School was virtually closed down, put on special measures, nearly closed down because of that issue with an 8-year-old girl. The mindset of the world is moving rapidly. There will be suffering to come, I've no doubt. But Paul says this, "For I consider the suffering of this present time not to be worthy compared to the glory that is to be revealed in us." Now, literally, the word in the Greek that is used is the word to consider. And it's a mathematical term. It literally says, I calculate, I count this for being true. The word worthy and even the word glory are related to Old Testament concepts of weight. When the Shekinah glory of God came upon the temple, it fell upon them like a weight, like a presence. Like something almost physical that drove them to the knees and it drove them to the ground. And that Old Testament idea of glory is that this glory, if you like, is tangible, that this has weight upon it. And Paul's saying that this idea is, you might feel weighted down, if you like, by the heaviness of suffering. However, the heaviness of your glory will far outweigh all that you've endured. It's like, let's have a pair of scales, and on one side we put down a grain of sand, and on the other side we put down the rock of Gibraltar. There is no equivalent. That's exactly what Paul is saying. There is no comparison between the glory to come and the suffering that we have now. And every time we feel the suffering of God here, recognize that what it's going to mean that in the future, you will look upon this as nothing. As I said, and Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4:17, this light and momentary affliction is preparing us for eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. Now, Paul tells us what this light and momentary affliction was. Are you ready? Have a listen to this. This is Paul's idea of light affliction. Five times I was received at the hands of the Jews and had 40 lashes, less one. That means 39 stripes. Imagine being whipped 39 times. Well, he had it five times over in his relatively short life of preaching the gospel. Three times, he said, I was beaten with rods. Once, I was stoned. Three times, I was shipwrecked. A night and a day, I was adrift at sea. On frequent journeys, in dangers from rivers, and in danger from robbers, in danger from his own people, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the wilderness, in danger at sea, in danger from false brothers, in toil and hardship, through many a sleepless night, in hunger and thirst, often without food, in cold and exposure. And apart from all the other things, there was the daily pressure of my anxiety for all the churches. Wow. This light and momentary affliction is preparing us for the eternal weight of glory. So, friends, I want us to understand that we have to see our lives in the light of eternity, even as we live them by the minute, the hour, the day. We have to somehow see our future wrapped up intrinsically with our present. Paul makes the point here that creation itself feels like you do. It says, for your anxious longing, for the anxious longing of creation, waits eagerly for the revealing of the sons of God. Do you know what that means? Creation's waiting to see your transformation. Creating is waiting to see the day. Because the day that we are transformed and liberated, it too will be liberated. It was man's sin that put the thorns on roses. The nature that we see around us is not the nature that was ever intended to be. When man fell, we cannot understand what looked like before the fall. But we do know that what looked like afterwards bore no relation to what lay before. We understand that creation itself, with death and decay, is not in the plan and the purpose of God. And one day nature will be transformed, so not only will there be the new heaven, there will be the new earth. And when we see him, we will be like him. And what happened to Jesus? Something incredible. It wasn't just the fact that he was resurrected. It wasn't just the fact that he came back. He came back into a body that wasn't the same as it was before. He came back into a body that was real. He could sit on the beach and cook fish for the disciples and eat with them. It was real that he could say, Thomas, put your finger in these hands, in the holes where the nails have been. And it was supernatural enough to appear in an upper room with locked doors. It was supernatural enough that he could cloak who he really was while walking with two disciples on the road to Emmaus and then reveal himself when he wanted. You see, friends, that is what we are going to become. When we see him, we shall be like him. It says continually that he was the first fruits. The first fruits, the very first bud upon the tree. The very first fruit that was plucked off and given as a sacrifice. And it was given as a sacrifice to say, here's this tiny little thing here. Lord, we've given it to you as a first fruit because we recognize that this tiny little thing here will be followed by the incredible harvest that is still to come. When we see Christ risen from the dead, he is the first fruits of the millions and millions and millions that shall become like him. And as he received his glorified body, we will receive our glorified bodies too. And this present suffering will be nothing in comparison to the weight of glory that lies ahead. But not only is it not comparable, it is directly relatable. The greater degree of suffering we have here, the greater degree of glory that lies ahead. Now, I believe in divine healing. I believe that God can heal people. But I also believe the nature of the word miracle tells us something. A miracle is not the norm. A miracle is the exception. And everybody who's been healed in the past still dies. Miracles happen for a reason. They happen to bring glory to God. They're a sign of God's intervention into nature. They're a sign of his power, and they're intended to bring people to him and to give glory to his name, and we believe that, don't we? But it's not the norm. The norm is that we go through suffering, and it's easy to turn around and say, Lord, why don't I have a miracle? You see, I don't believe, as the extreme health and wealth people do, when they talk glibly on these matters at times, and they turn around and they say, you know, it's a sort of name it and claim it law of the universe, that if you do 1, 2, 3, you know, you'll get it. Do you understand? Because that's not scriptural. God can heal and will heal as he will. And he'll do it to bring glory to his name. But friends, we all suffer. What God's saying to you this morning is don't be discouraged. Because that suffering that you feel now will shortly be outweighed completely by my plans for you in the future. When you become transformed. Thank God. And so for the one miracle that takes place, I thank God. But for all the people standing alongside that aren't, I thank God too. You know, it's easy to turn around and say, Lord, do you care? Why is that person had a miracle and not me? Where's the hand of God? And Jesus lifts out his hands with the nail prints in them and says, does this look like the hand of somebody that doesn't care? I thank God that creation, although it's fallen, is looking forward to the day. I look forward to the day myself every time I have a problem with my back, and you can look forward with all your problems and all your difficulties. And I've got a blessed life, I've got to say. I'm absolutely blessed. I'm probably the happiest person I know. No, seriously, I mean it. I keep getting amazed because I'm happy. I talk to people and find they're not happy, and I get surprised. Because honestly, God's blessed me, and I'm over the moon. But I know that I'm under the bondage to decay. I know that, good grief, the years are ticking. Where's the year gone? It's November. Is it November today? Yes. Tomorrow? Tuesday. What happened? What happened? It was only yesterday, it was Christmas. And then my wife's telling us we need to get the Christmas list ready again. Can't be. It just happened. It hasn't. I've only got used to writing 2016. It was only last week I was still writing 2015. And each year that goes by, you suddenly realize I'm becoming a codger. It's true. I'll stand next to you, Cliff. I was sarcastic earlier on. I've got to asking for forgiveness. Yeah? You were stood there with your phone and said, the age of technology. And I whispered at the back, no, it's the age. Ha. The whole of creation groans. Listen, just something along the way here that really struck me about the fact that it says that nature waits this day. I'm a nut for getting into Greek words and figuring out what they originally meant. And this is a doozy. Are you ready for this one? The phrase anxious looking literally means to stand and watch with an outstretched neck. That's the word, an outstretched neck. J.B. Phillips translates this version. He says, nature's on its tiptoes. Because it's right, that goes with the neck, doesn't it? Because as soon as you nick out your neck, you stand on your tiptoes. That's the image, can you imagine? Creation standing on its tiptoes going like this, saying, when's it going to happen? I can see Steve Young down there. When's he going to be transformed into the Son of God? Because the minute he is, I'm going to be too. The Bible says that in this period, while this groaning takes place, the Holy Spirit intercedes for us. Great. But remember something here, that actually it says the Holy Spirit helps us. Helps us. The Holy Spirit doesn't pray instead of us. When you're in trouble, and when you groan, and when you try, and if you speak in tongues, and I'll countenance everybody to pray like this, when your private time, pray in tongues, and say, God, I can't picture the words I need in my mind. You use the Holy Spirit through me to intercede for me. And so we pray like that. We pray in our weakness, but it says the Holy Spirit helps us. The Holy Spirit doesn't pray instead of us. We have to use our weakness, not as an excuse not to pray, but we have to remember that the Holy Spirit is alongside us to help us in our prayers. So in the midst of suffering, we need to be praying. In the midst of our problems, we need to be expressing, whether it's inexpressible groans, whether it is literally, Lord, and we cry. Understand the Holy Spirit is in us in those moments praying before God. And it will make a difference to us. It will make a difference to us. Well, it comes to our second part. I'll finish by Tuesday. No, we've got a meeting on Monday night. Throw things at us when I'm going on too long. But now we need to speak about this glory that lies ahead. You see, in some ways, I think we get glimpses of the glory. I'm going to be very carnal here. I'm going to be very worldly, so you can talk about this afterwards. But what I'm suggesting here is that we all have this yearning inside us that sort of recognizes hints and glimpses of the beauty that is to come. Somebody said that nature sort of plays in a minor key around us. I'm trying to remember who it was, but I can't. Where it's like all the sounds of nature are in a minor key. Listen to the sighing of the wind. Listen to the roaring of the tide. Listen to the waterfalls. Listen to the bird songs. They're nearly always in a minor key, and it's like nature singing a song of bondage. But it's at the same time, is this song of hope that looks forward one day to its redemption? Looking forward one day to the time when we shall be free. We get these glimpses and these moments and we try and replicate them. I told you I'm going to be carnal. I enjoy an occasional glass of wine. I mean very occasional now. I've got diabetes and I'm not allowed to drink. But occasionally I'll have a glass of wine. I remember vividly sitting in a great restaurant in North Yorkshire. And I've forgotten exactly the dish, but it was king prawn something. But it was very posh. You know what posh means when it comes to food. You don't get a lot of it. The posher it is, the more they shrink the plate. No, that's not true. They give you a bigger plate, but less on it. It was one of those places. And The waiter is, waiters always seem superior, don't they? Don't they always make you feel as if you know nothing? The wine waiters especially. Would you like a wine with that? And you know as soon as you're going to make a choice, they're going to raise an eyebrow. Really? Is that what you're choosing? So I thought, I'll go ahead of the game here. I said, look, this prawn thing is fabulous. I'm sure it's going to be wonderful. Could you recommend a wine that would go with that? So he did. He was very kind. I've forgotten how much the bottle was, so I nearly had a heart attack. But we had a bottle of Cloudy Bay Sauvignon Blanc from New Zealand. Now, this is at the moment where everybody was going doolally over this wine. You couldn't buy it anywhere, right? I didn't know that. I just thought, oh, that's nice. And I had a sip of this wine, and it was glorious. I felt as if my cheeks had been slapped several times and pulled inside out, but it was in a nice way. Yeah, and you get it. Well, you know, for months and months afterwards, I saved up so I could buy a bottle of this from the off-license, if I could find it. And we were up in Ponteland, and we were in the wine merchants there, and I found a bottle of Cloudy Bay, and I was like, yes. So I got it and brought it back. And I got some king prawns. Not at the off-license, they don't. And I made this dish, and I'm a decent cook at times. Sometimes I get it wrong, but I'm a decent cook at times. And I had this moment, and I had my lovely wife sitting down at the table with me, prawns, Cloudy Bay. Do you know something? It was all right. I'd invested in this moment for months and months and months, trying to replicate it. Because there was something incredibly special about the time that we had it, and it's like, I want that again. I want that feeling again. Do you know what I mean? I want to feel again what I felt in that moment. And sometimes this moment might be a sunset. It might be you see the sunset and something inside your soul echoes, resonates, and you feel, oh God, your handiwork. I remember standing at a top floor of a college building in Teesside. And there was a colleague with us who was an ex-monk. And I'm looking at this fabulous, fabulous sunset. And I'm, wow. And he says, it's just weather patterns. It's just weather. Oh. Every poet who's ever had deep insight into the nature of nature, every songsmith who's managed to capture a few lines of melody, a few words that resonate with us, everybody is glimpsing into a world of pleasure, into a world of appreciation of God, into a world of experience that we cannot replicate. We cannot sum up to tell anybody about, because it's something that's inside, and we just resonate with it like two strings on a guitar, resonating with each other. And one string by itself doesn't resonate with another, and what's happening in our life is resonating with eternity. I've got to tell you, friends, the Bible is full of language that speaks about pleasure. At his right hand there are joys forevermore. The creation around about us is now in bondage and decay, but one day we'll be liberated. Can you imagine the day when you see a rose as God intended it to be? Can you imagine the perfume that will come from the flower, the humblest of flower in your garden, when you see it born on the new earth? Friends, do you understand where I'm coming from here? There is a glory in God that lies ahead. And it's writ large through the scriptures in words of beauty and words of pleasure. And so often Christians are sort of accused of being people who are not into pleasure, as if we're all sort of Puritans. No, friends, we will find the poetry of God in the world to come. We will find pleasures that we cannot imagine. We will experience life as God designed it. He is gone to prepare a place for us. He is the master builder. He is the craftsman. He is the great architect, and that's not in a Masonic sense in the slightest, but true. Do you understand the world that we're going to be in when we have our resurrected bodies, when we rise with Christ and are never parted with Him, when we reign with Him, when we stand on the first day of eternity, if we can imagine such a thing, the grand scales of life with our suffering on one side and our glory in God on the other. Hallelujah. It will be worth it. Hallelujah. I've had a horrible thought. The clock's moved, didn't it, today? Is that clock right, or is it 1 o'clock? Oh, that's okay. I tell you, a glory to God, we one day are going to be forever with Christ. What should this do to us next week? Friends, let this hope of Christ in us, let this excitement reign that one day we shall be as we truly are inside, we shall be outside, we shall be transformed. The down payment of heaven that God has lodged within your heart and soul, the Holy Spirit, the down payment of heaven. Let the Holy Spirit reign in your life. Pray with His help. In every tear, remember that He will wipe away every tear. In every suffering, remember it will be replaced with a weight of glory. For every imperfection of life, remember that you are loved by one who shared in humanity. God became man, truly man and truly God. God nailed to a cross, God whipped within an inch in His life, God beaten in the face, God wearing a crown of thorns, God suffering out of love for you. He now invites us to live in that love, to share in His suffering. And just as the early church did, they rejoiced in their sufferings because it identified them with Christ. Let's face this week as the people we are, not the people we look like. Let's be in Christ. The Lord bless you.